Thank you. Our next speaker is Senator Dan Squadron.
Thank you very much, Madam Chair and Committee. It's good timing, and I want to pick up right where Assembly Member Graff left off with, I think he referred to it as a non-existent 3030 statute. In fact, might be better off with none than with this. Current 3030 statute was written in order to keep the federal government from coming into New York State in the early 70s, signed by Governor Rockefeller in contradiction to a report from the court on how to actually fix our speedy trial statute at a time when court congestion wasn't as bad as it is today. I appreciate your testimony. I understand that the Commission on Judicial Pay ties your hands a little bit, but I do want to say, when we have the kind of delay and backup that we see, when we have the kind of violation of the accused constitutional rights, the kind of cost and pain suffered by victims from the sort of court delay that we have, I really urge, and I've done the same thing to the incoming chief judge, an aggressive look at a crisis of court delay, a crisis of constitutional rights to a speedy trial being absolutely ignored in New York State. In fact, the statute to protect them is used to damage them. In my home borough of Brooklyn, we're up 26% on court delays in 2015. In 2013, in New York City, 594 days citywide, mean age of disposition. 594 is almost 2 years. 732 days in the Bronx. 2012, 55% of felony cases in New York City were pending for more than 6 months. That is a crisis. In fact, the Advisory Committee on Criminal Law and Procedure gave a report to you last year that said most would agree, as you have already, which I really appreciate, that 3030 has been largely unsuccessful in moving criminal trials in an expeditious fashion. It also says the problem is more than just a lack of sufficient judicial resources. It also involves a willingness to go to trial. You said in response to Senator Hassel-Thompson that people are sitting in jail because they can't make bail. I would amend that. They're sitting in jail because they can't make bail and because of the kind of court delays we have. I carry a bill to fix this, named for Khalif Browder, who spent more than 1,000 days in jail before having his case dismissed, tragically committed suicide last year. What's the solution? How are we going to do it together this year?
I think that these are all real problems that you've discussed, and the solution is, and I think the new chief judge is very interested in this problem, and I think you'll be hearing more from her shortly about this, but I think she wants to address and focus her attention on this, and this has to be a priority. It will be a priority, but I think the ultimate solution, the criminal justice system has many components, and obviously the court system is a central component within the criminal justice system, but to eliminate some of these problems, address these delays, streamline the process, we have to work together with the other components of the criminal justice system. There's a lot that we can do ourselves, that the judiciary can do, but we can't do it all, and we need to work with law enforcement, with the defense bar, with the institutional criminal defense providers, with probation departments. I mean, we need to work together with all the components of the criminal justice system to solve these problems. That's the only way to do it.
And just explain to me the role of the court system, and then the role of the other partners you just described.
In the role that what?
Of the partners you just described.
Have a major role, maybe the critical role. Right.
And what is that role, just sort of more specifically?
Well, in the end, it's the judge that can move the case to trial. I mean, the parties have to be ready, but if there's delay or lack of readiness, if there are excuses, in the end, it's the judge that has to ensure that there's a quick resolution, an expeditious resolution of the case. So first and foremost, and ultimately, the responsibility is with the court system and with judges.
Let me just ask this question directly. If court congestion didn't stop the clock, wouldn't that move trials a lot more quickly?
If
court congestion wasn't a reason to stop the speedy trial clock, wouldn't that move trials much more quickly?
Absolutely.
Is that something you support?
Is that what?
Something you support?
Oh,
allowing
sure.
the clock to run for the entire time between trial or hearing dates, even if it's court congestion that's leading to the delay?
You mean if court congestion was the reason for the delay?
The prosecutor asks for a week and gets a date 3 weeks hence. Is that 7 days or is that 21 days?
Under the speedy trial statute?
Currently it's seven. If it were 21, I think that would be the beginning of solving this problem. I'm asking, is that something that the court system would support?
Look, a more effective speedy trial statute could make a great contribution to eliminating delays in criminal cases, no question.
Okay. And so it sounds like you also agree that we don't need more money before we talk about fixing speedy trial. We should fix 30-30, and then next year we'll talk about the money that we need to make that work. Is that the right order of operations?
I think there are a lot of things we can do without more money.
Thank you very much. I really appreciate it.
Thank you.